At the end of the topic, you will be able to understand that matter is composed of tiny indivisible particles called atoms. Explain law of conservation of mass. Explain law of definite proportions. The concept of an atom is originated from Greek philosophers like Democritus and John Dalton. Democritus studied the nature of matter and the constituents of all the substances. In 1808, John Dalton put forward atomic theory to explain the law of chemical combination. According to him, an atom is the smallest unit of matter which take part in a chemical reaction. He considered that atoms are indivisible particles. At the end of the 18th and 20th century, modern concept an atom developed by scientists like J.J. Thomson, Goldstein, Rutherford, Bohr, and others.
The Greek philosopher Democritus in 400 BC defined an atom as eternal and invisible and absolutely small, so small that its size cannot be diminished, absolutely full and incompressible. They are without pause and entirely fill the space they occupy. Unfortunately, Democritus had no experimental evidences.
Laws of chemical combination. Compounds are formed by chemical combination of reactants, that is, atoms or molecules which may be solid, liquid or gaseous. Chemical combination occurs in definite proportion by weight or by volume. Based on various experiments performed by different scientists, the laws of chemical combination were formulated. These laws laid the foundation of stoichiometry, a branch of chemistry in which quantitative relationship between masses of reactants and products were established. The study of these laws led to the development of a theory concerning the nature of matter. The quantitative aspects of chemical changes are governed by certain laws called the law of chemical combination. They are law of conservation of mass, law of definite proportions, law of multiple proportions. Let us learn these laws in detail. Law of conservation of mass. Whenever a chemical change occurs, the total mass of products is the same as the total mass of reactants.
Experiment 1. To prove the law of conservation of mass. Take some sodium sulfate solution in a conical flask. Introduce a test tube containing some barium chloride solution as shown in the figure. Weigh the whole apparatus on a balance. Note down the initial reading as seen on the weighing balance. Tilt the conical flask so that the two solutions are mixed up. Now you can see that barium chloride reacts with sodium sulfate to give a white precipitate of barium sulfate and sodium chloride. Again, weigh the whole apparatus. You will be surprised to see that there is no change in the weight before and after the reaction. Try the experiment in your laboratory. Experiment 2. To prove the law of conservation of mass. Take silver nitrate and sodium chloride solutions in a separate beaker as shown. Weigh the two beakers and note down the reading as initial. Now, mix silver nitrate solution with sodium chloride slowly as shown here. Observe the changes. A white precipitate of silver chloride is formed. Again, weigh the whole apparatus. We can infer that there is no change in the weight before and after the reaction. Some more examples of law of conservation of mass. Potassium chlorate is converted to potassium chloride and oxygen. calcium oxide reacts with water to give calcium hydroxide. Zinc reacts with copper sulfate to give zinc sulfate and copper. In all these chemical changes, the sum of the weights of the reactants is exactly equal to the sum of the weights of the products. Let us define the law of definite proportions. When two or more elements combine to form a compound, they combine in a fixed ratio of their weights. The ratio is independent of the method of formation of the compound.
Experiment 1. To prove the law of definite proportions, take magnesium ribbons of different lengths, roughly 0.5 cm, 1.0 cm, 1.5 cm and 2.0 cm. Weigh them and record the weights. Burn each of them separately and collect the ash formed in different china dish. Weigh the ash. The difference between the weights of magnesium and ash gives a weight of oxygen that combines with magnesium in each case. Now, find the ratio by which magnesium combines with oxygen. We can observe that the ratio is constant in all the cases. This shows that the elements combine in a fixed ratio by weight. This holds good for compounds formed by different methods but from the same elements.
In this topic you have learnt, from the experiments, we infer that during a chemical change, matter is neither created nor destroyed, but it undergoes physical and chemical changes. This is known as the law of conservation of mass. A pure chemical compound always contains the same elements combined together in the same definite, that is, fixed or constant proportions by weight, irrespective of its source or method of preparations. Therefore, the law is also called as the law of fixed proportions or constant proportions.
At the end of the topic, you will be able to describe Dalton's atomic theory. John Dalton, son of a poor weaver, began his career as a village school teacher at the age of 12. He became principal of the school 7 years later. In 1793, he moved to Manchester to teach physics, chemistry and mathematics in a college. He proposed his atomic theory in 1803. He carefully recorded each day the temperature, pressure and amount of rainfall from his youth till the end. He was a meticulous meteorologist. Postulates of Dalton's atomic theory. Matter is made up of small, indivisible particles called atoms. Atoms can neither be created nor be destroyed. Atoms of the same element are identical in all respects. Atoms of different elements are different in all respects. Atoms of different elements may combine with each other in a fixed simple whole number ratio to form compound atoms or molecules. Atom is the smallest particle that take part in a chemical reaction. Merits of Dalton's atomic theory. It gave a satisfactory explanation for the law of chemical combinations, law of conservation of mass, and law of definite proportions. It explained most of the properties of gases and liquids known at that time. Demerits of Dalton's atomic theory. It failed to explain why the atoms of different elements differ in their size, mass, and valency. It failed to explain how and why atoms of different elements combined together to form compound atoms. It also did not explain the nature of binding forces that keeps the atoms together in a compound. It could not give a clear distinction between the atom and the molecule. In this topic, you have learnt postulates of Dalton's atomic theory, merits of Dalton's atomic theory, demerits of Dalton's atomic theory.
At the end of the topic, you will be able to Understand the electrical nature of matter. Introduction. You have observed and experienced many phenomena that are examples of the electrical nature of matter. During the winter, you have experienced a shock by walking over a rug and then touching a metal object, or by sliding across your automobile seat and touching the door handle. You have seen bolts of lightning. Clothes you take out of a clothes dryer often cling together due to static electricity. A heart is an electric device that keeps its steady beat with electric synchronization. These examples all involve the electrical nature of matter and electric interactions. Activity 1. For understanding the electrical nature of matter, let us carry out the following activities. Materials required: bits of paper and a plastic comb. Take a few bits of paper and place them on the table. Comb dry hair repeatedly with a plastic comb. Immediately bring the comb close to small bits of paper. Yes, the comb attracts small bits of paper. When two objects are rubbed, they become electrically charged. Activity 2. For understanding the electrical nature of matter, let us carry out one more activity. Materials required: glass rod, a bit of silk cloth, and an inflated balloon. Rub a glass rod with a silk cloth. Bring the rod near an inflated balloon. The inflated balloon will get attracted towards the glass rod, charged. Any uncharged object will get attracted to a charged object. From these activities, we can conclude that on rubbing two objects together, they become electrically charged. Where does this charge come from? This question can be answered by knowing that an atom consists of charged particles. Electrical nature of matter. The first direct experimental evidence from the electrical nature of matter came from the experiments of Michael Faraday. He proved through his experiments that electricity is composed of particles called atoms of electricity. It was George Johnstone Stoney, an Irish physicist, who first proposed the word electron from atom of electricity in 1891. His contribution to research in this area laid the foundations for the eventual discovery of particles by J.J. Thomson in 1897. Discovery of fundamental particle. In 1878, Sir William Crookes, while conducting an experiment using a discharge tube, found certain visible rays traveling between two metal electrodes. These rays are known as Crookes rays or cathode rays. The discharge tube used in the experiment is now referred to as Crookes tube, or more popularly as cathode ray tube. It is a long glass tube filled with gas and sealed at both the ends. It consists of two metal plates which act as electrodes connected with high voltage. The electrode which is connected to the negative terminal of the battery is called the cathode. Negative electrode. The electrode connected to the positive terminal is called the anode. Positive electrode. There is a side tube which is connected to a pump. The pump is used to lower the pressure inside the discharge tube. Discovery of electron. J.J. Thomson also found that when a high voltage of 10,000 volts was applied between the electrodes present in a partially evacuated cathode ray tube at a pressure of 0.01 mm of mercury, a bright spot of light was formed on the screen, coated with a fluorescent material placed at the other end of the tube. The fluorescent material coated on the screen started to glow because it was struck by the ray which originated from the cathode. Since these rays were emitted by the cathode rays, later he named them as electrons. Properties of cathode rays. Experiment 1. J.J. Thomson and others studied the properties of these cathode and anode. A shadow which is of the same size and shape as that of the object is observed on the wall opposite to the cathode. Conclusion: cathode rays travel in straight lines parallel to each other. Experiment 2. Cathode rays fall on a light paddle wheel which is placed between the cathode and anode. The wheel starts rotating. Conclusion: Cathode rays are made up of small particles that have mass and kinetic energy. Experiment 3. Cathode rays are passed through an electric field. Cathode rays are deflected towards the positive plate of electric field. Conclusion: cathode rays are negatively charged particles. Experiment 4. Cathode rays are passed through a magnetic field. The deflection of the rays is perpendicular to the applied magnetic field. Conclusion: the direction of deflection indicates that the cathode rays are negatively charged particles. These negatively charged particles are called electrons. Experiment 5. These experiments are repeated by taking different gases or different cathodes in the discharge tube. No change in properties. Conclusion: the nature of the cathode rays does not depend on the nature of the gas inside the tube or the cathode used. Discovery of protons. The presence of positively charged particles in the atom has been predicted by Goldstein based on the conception that the atom, being electrically neutral in nature, should necessarily possess charged particles to balance the negatively charged electrons. Goldstein's experiment, 1886. Goldstein repeated the cathode ray experiment by using a perforated cathode. On applying a high voltage under low pressure, he observed a faint red glow on the wall behind the cathode. Since these rays originated from the anode, they were called rays or canal rays or positive rays. Anode rays were found as a stream of positively charged particles. When hydrogen gas taken in a discharge tube, the positively charged particles obtained from hydrogen gas are called protons. Each of these protons is produced when one electron is removed from one hydrogen atom. H gives H plus plus E minus. Thus, proton can be defined as hydrogen ion. Properties of anode rays. Anode rays travel in straight lines. Since they rotate the light paddle wheel placed in their path, they consist of material particles. Anode rays are deflected by electric and magnetic field. Since they are deflected towards the negatively charged plate, they consist of positively charged particles. The properties of anode rays depend upon the nature of gas taken in the discharge tube. The mass of the particle is the same as the atomic mass of the gas taken inside the discharge tube. In this topic, you have learnt. In 1878, Sir William Crookes, while conducting an experiment using a discharge tube, found certain visible rays known as Crookes rays or cathode rays. J.J. Thomson found that when a high voltage of 10,000 volts was applied between the electrodes present in partially evacuated cathode ray tube, at a pressure of 0.01 mm of mercury, a bright spot of light was formed on the screen coated with the fluorescent materials. The cathode and anode rays travel in straight lines. Cathode rays are made up of small particles that have mass and kinetic energy. The cathode rays are negatively charged particles. The nature of the cathode rays does not depend on the nature of the gas inside the tube or the cathode used. The properties of anode rays depend upon the nature of gas taken in the discharge tube.
In this topic, you will be able to appreciate Thomson's model of an atom, atomic model.
Will we say no to a piece of watermelon on a hot sunny day? What comes to your mind when you look into plum puddings arranged on a rack in a bakery on Christmas Eve? What correlation can you make between our solar system and the structure of an atom? Yes, all three are associated with the structure of an atom. Although these imageries appear as just imaginative pictures of the structure, these form the basis for what we believe today as atomic structure. But why is there a focus for defining an atom of the 19th century? As we all know, in simple words, an atom is the basis of all substances. We define matter as composed of atoms that have mass and that which occupy space. Thus, an atom took the center of attraction during the 19th century.
Thomson's atomic model, 1904. Thomson's atomic model can be compared with the watermelon or a ripened guava. In watermelon, the red edible portion represents the positive sphere and the black seeds are like electrons embedded. According to J.J. Thomson, an atom consists of a positively charged sphere and electrons are embedded in that sphere. The positive and the negative charges are equal in magnitude. Hence, the atom as a whole is electrically neutral. Thomson's model of an atom is popularly known as plum pudding model. Limitations of Thomson's model. Thomson's model could successfully explain the electrical neutrality of an atom. However, it failed to explain how the positively charged sphere is shielded from the negatively charged electrons without getting neutralized. In this topic, you have learned an atom consists of a positively charged sphere and electrons are embedded in that sphere. The positive and negative charges are equal in magnitude, hence the atom as a whole is electrically neutral. Limitation of Thomson's model.